I want this to be your favorite class for a lot of reasons. Because I think it's interesting, I think it's incredibly topical, and hopefully my insights and experience have added to it. What I want to do today, I can't believe it's like the last class in mid-November, but whatever. I wanted to get to this referee strike, not strike, lockout, and give you a glimpse into another labor group that is involved in sports, and it happens in every sport. They are unionized, which I didn't even know until this happened a few years ago, where we have referees, officials, involved in labor disputes. So I'm going to go through this one. It was the NFL replacements and referee lockout. I've had some questions about just give you some brief glimpses into agent life, maybe a couple stories as we finish up. And at 4, we'll break, and I'll come back with our speaker for the day. Turns out it's our last class, but that's when it was scheduled. The general manager of the Eagles, Howie Roseman, unfortunately has canceled at the last minute. He is sending his cap and contract administrator, Jake Rosenberg. So Jake will give you a little more insight into, as a younger member of the staff, kind of a lot of the stuff I did for the Packers, cap contracts, working with both the general manager and the business side. And so Jake will be here. Sorry you won't get to hear from Howie, but I think in some ways it could be more instructive, especially as young lawyers coming out, hearing kind of getting into it at a younger level, although he's not so young. He had a career in management consulting before getting into football. But you'll hear from Jake, and you'll have to hear from Howie another time. I'm sure he's going to come back sometime this year. We'll get him in our speaker series. But, you know, I was maybe a little ambitious, thinking he'd be here in the middle of the season, but even after a bye week, he says at the last minute something came up. Not something earth-shattering with the team, don't worry, fans. Just something came up. Okay, so we'll get through all that, and we'll break at 4, bring up Jake. Jake will start around 4:10 or so, and we'll go till 5. All right. The referees, let's see. So there was a CBA, just like we talk about CBAs for players, for owners, there was one for the refs. And again, maybe some of you didn't know, I didn't know at some point that the referees were unionized, they have their own union. It's depending on the sport, MLB RA, MLB Referees Association, NBA RA, NFL RA. The Referees Association had an agreement with the NFL, and they're negotiating just like players do on all the terms and conditions of employment, which can be wages and hours, and more importantly for a lot of these guys, pension and insurance and benefits after they are done being reps. So they had agreement expired. Remember we talked about the Powell case and expiration. That was so important to the players, which eventually led to decertification, etc. This one expired in May, the off season of a few years ago in 2012. As always the case, negotiations ensued. Negotiations probably going on long before May 2012. And they broke off. And they broke off in such a way where the NFL wanted to impose their will, as I keep saying, because they felt these referees were getting a little too, for lack of a better word, uppity, that they were getting a little too full of themselves, that maybe they thought they were part of the game, and in fact they weren't. And really, in a bold move, they said, we're going to go start to talk to potential replacements. Replacement referees. So they did. And this went on during the preseason where the referees were, and this is what happens with these end of collective bargaining agreements, locked out. So we've seen players strike, we've seen owners lock out. In this case, the owners locked out. In other words, they said, okay, you don't want to accept our terms and conditions of a new collective bargaining agreement? Fine. We'll replace you. Okay? Pretty bold, pretty aggressive negotiating stance. So, we now are in the preseason of 2012, and I'm sure a lot of you remember this, and they're out there. Now, who are these guys? A lot of high school refs who are now going way up levels, all the way to the top level of the sport. Now, why, you should be asking, weren't the top college refs doing this? Because two reasons. One, they didn't want to sort of cross the picket line on the top NFL refs. But two, more importantly, they knew, like you and I know, that at some point these refs are going to cave and are going to give in and want their jobs back. So if they left college football and whatever they had to do to leave it, probably extricate themselves from college football, like quit, they knew it wouldn't last. So any of these referees that were quote unquote top level were not taking these jobs, even though it was reffing an NFL game. Remember I talked about my clients that wanted to play an NFL game even though they were scrubs on the team? Yeah. So referees, yeah. I'm going to ref the NFL? Sure. So they're signing them up. And these guys are actually reffing. Here are the issues with that lockout, with that negotiation. The issue that's always the case, obviously, is money. But as I'll talk about, this was one case where the money really wasn't the main issue. In every other negotiation pretty much in your life, you're looking at money being a primary issue. This wasn't. This wasn't. There's pension, big issue. And then the issue is sort of non-economic. Are there going to be full-time officials? And are there going to be extra crews, backups, not just the crews that work the games, but backups, and you can imagine what that means. So the money issue, like I said, wasn't a big issue in terms of the overall settlement. What you have is about $150,000 average going into this. So take all the officials, the crews of like 7 times 16 games a week, whatever number that is, the average official is probably making about $150,000. They wanted to increase that, but that wasn't the huge issue. I mean, if that could get to $200,000, probably would have gotten the deal done. And as it says in the first bullet, what they're asking for overall, about $25 to $30 million, which if you divide it out would probably bring the average to about $200,000. That, in this context, at that time a $9 or $10 billion industry, now $15 billion industry, yeah, in that context, chump change. So the money, if you're the negotiator for either side, the money is not really going to be the big issue. You can come up with compromise on $25 to $30 million in that kind of industry. What were the bigger issues? The pension. What happened in the old agreement was these officials had a pension. And again, I'm not an insurance expert, but a pension is a much more valuable benefit than these defined contribution plans that they were offering, 401ks. So a pension is a much more valuable asset than a 401k. What the officials are saying, no, we've got to have the pension. We've had the pension. And the owners are saying, no, our employees at the league don't even have pensions. I don't know how you got that pension the last time, but we're going to 401ks for everybody. And certainly when I was in the NFL, I never had a pension. I had a 401k. So this is what the battle was there. Especially you have a lot of older officials that are really banking on that pension for retirement. So that was a big issue. The non-economic issues, full-time, there you see Hockley and his guns. These guys were second jobs. So they're lawyers, they're judges, they're transportation officials, they're referees in other sports. The guy Steratore, Gene Steratore is a referee in football. I saw him do a Monday night game last year on TV. Then I go to the pavilion Tuesday night, and there he is, reffing our Villanova team. So that's his real job, college basketball, which is a lot more busy than football. So these guys have other jobs. And here's the thing. They're willing to go full-time with the NFL, but if that's only if they pay like Major League Baseball, which is paying guys $350,000 average. They're not going to go full-time. They want to keep their other job. They only work 20 weekends a year. Well, the NFL wants some full-time refs. For what? For accountability. Now, you're asking, well, what do they do the other, 30 weeks a year? Well, get sharper, get fitter, do eye testing, whatever it is. Review film. So those are the kind of things. They kept going back and forth. You can imagine the sort of cat and mouse game here. NFL says, we want you to be full-time. They go, great, pay us full-time, like baseball officials or basketball officials. They say, no, you only work 20 weekends a year. They say, well, yeah, that's why we want to be part-time. So the NFL kind of wanted it both ways. They wanted full-time officials, but they didn't want to pay that much more to give them full-time jobs. But clearly, these guys like having two jobs. They like going back to their communities and being whatever, lawyers or judges or whatever they are, and then going off to do their games. And then the other issue is to have a backup role. The league wanted to hire 21 officials to deepen their bench, accountability. That's the big issue here. The NFL was feeling these officials weren't accountable. You didn't have backups. You didn't have a bench. You didn't have stress on these guys to make the right call, where they could be replaced. So when you bring up the issue of a backup, it's a threat to their job security. So the officials, the NFLRA, really fought this. They really fought this. All the while this is going on, of course, this is the issue. This is the negotiation. But while this negotiation goes on, as I keep mentioning, we're having NFL games not with replacement players like back in 88, but with replacement officials, with high school officials, junior high school officials. It's happening. So different people get involved. You have the players union. They had just come off their own lockout and their own new collective bargaining agreement. And they're seeing if there's a way that they could potentially strike because they're not getting the real officials. This is a public safety, this is a player safety concern, right? If you don't have the best people officiating the game, it could be a safety issue. So they try to invoke a union security issue in Article 47 of the CBA, but union security, as the third bullet says, really only refers to their status as a union, not health and safety of the players. Federal law would allow for a strike if there were dramatically dangerous work conditions, but that's a stretch. It wasn't more dramatically dangerous with sub-officials than it would be otherwise. I felt for these guys. I interviewed them on ESPN. I felt for these guys. They were not equipped to do this. And as I said, they were pawns. They were pawns in this negotiating game. These replacement officials, they just wanted to have an experience in the NFL. They weren't qualified. They were getting bullied by players and coaches, just bullied. And these poor guys were pawns. They didn't ask to be that. They did, because they took the job, but they were really treated especially poorly by players and coaches. Again, this was a tough negotiation. Owners were not backing down. And then you have the owners saying things that made it sound like it's no big deal. The Texans owner, we have complaints, it doesn't matter who's officiating, I don't see any difference.
Yeah, right.
Cowboys owner Jones, I haven't seen any difference, because I can take the game at disjuncture and come up with criticism of officiating, nothing to do with these replacements. Well, that's what they have to say. They have to say all is well with replacements. On the player's side, of course, you had the players losing out on different touchdowns or everything. And you have players chiming in. Victor Cruz saying, I heard one of the refs, he said he only ref high school games, glorified high school games. I don't know what that means. The Bears, Robbie Gould, the coaches get upset because the refs are clueless. NFL, when did you stop caring about the integrity of the game? So this was the constant battle in the media on who's going to win the media side. And again, the NFLPA, the union, really making statements in the media about greed. The last line, you cannot simply switch to a group of cheaper officials. Fulfill your legal, moral, and duty to fans. You need to end the lockup. Bring the officials back immediately. Again, but these are all statements. So they negotiate, and then it comes down to this, was the tipping point. How do I do this again? Sarah. It ended after the tipping point where the Packers game, the touchception as it was called, landed in the Green Bay Packers arms as an interception to end the game, but the Seattle guy took it. One ref called touchdown, one ref called interception, the game ended, no one knew, and of course Seattle went on to win. Huge problem. I remember we did Sports Center at 3 in the morning. It was like one of the highest rated of the year because everyone wanted to vent about this. You had the Green Bay Packers side, of course. TJ Lang playing for the team, got effed by the refs, embarrassing. Greg Jennings, eff it, find me. You had Drew Brees. Love the game, but this is not the league we're supposed to represent. Tonight's debit goal hurts me greatly. Tony Gonzalez, had you missed that, Pop Warner ref would have gotten that right. I mean, obviously this set off a reaction. You had LeBron, I love football, his replacement refs gotta go. Packers just got the game took from them. Even Bubba Watson chimed in, watch the Ryder Cup, we got no refs. So, you see where it was going. Let me get back to that. How do I get back to... There it is. Okay, so it was resolved. After that was resolved, we'll go over the... And this was kind of a two-minute ode to the replacement refs. These poor guys.
I'm
And I cannot believe that there's no laundry on the field.
So what came out of this? After that play, it was resolved. Not surprisingly. I'll start with the second one. Money. Money went to exactly where everyone thought it would. It went from an average of about $150 a year. This is the average. I mean, again, you're talking about the older officials, it's pretty much by seniority, would make close to $250,000, $300,000 a year, but the younger ones, $60,000 to $70,000, $80,000, $100,000. Basically, it came out from an average of about $150,000 to $200,000. It's kind of what everyone thought it would. That wasn't the issue. Here's what they did on pension. They said the pension continues for current officials through 16. It was an 8-year CBA. So the first 4 years, they keep the pension. Once you get past the 4 years from 16 to 20, 2016 to 20, now no more pension. You're going to a defined benefit plan of a 401k. That's good for the older officials to keep it for 4 years. Some of those with 20 or more years, they still keep it even after the next 4 years. Okay, so it's a compromise. First 4 years of the deal, you're going to keep the pension. Next 4 years, you go into a 401k. Unless you have 20 years or more, then you keep your pension, satisfying the other refs. But here's the deal. Every negotiation, to me, is a setup for the next negotiation. So the next time the refs and the owners negotiate, what's going to be on the table about pension or defined benefit? Anyone? No pension. Because the deal that's going to be in place when they negotiate again, pension's gone, except for the older guys. So that was a real stroke by the NFL to say, all right, you keep your pension the first 4 years, it's gone. The next 4 years, next time we negotiate, probably never going to be a pension again. And then with the full-time officials and the extra crews, the NFL has given loose language about being able to hire full-time officials and being able to have backup crews. They do have backup crews. They have replaced underperforming officials. That's been happening. Full-time, we're told that every crew has seven refs, and we're told they're trying to get to one full-time each crew. I don't know how many crews there are, maybe 20, 15? But last time I checked, there were seven full-time officials. So out of hundreds, that's still not a lot of progress on that area. So what was the cost? Well, the head referees got $3,500 a game. the regular officials got 3,000 a game, alternates got 2,000 a game. That was a $3.1 million cost to the owners. The regular reps also got a $2.5 million bonus to return. So the $2.5 million was split among however, a couple hundred referees as kind of a gesture. In sum, I think the owners got off well because they were able to keep the game going with these replacements, come to where they needed to go anywhere on the money, $200,000 a year, and not have to give up a pension long term, and of course be able to hire these backup reps and full-time reps. Like a lot of these negotiations, obviously leverage comes from the ownership that can really live on even with replacements. It was a bad look for the NFL, of course it was. And then when these guys came back, I can guarantee this, maybe anyone would have another example of this, that will be the only standing ovation for referees in the history of the sport. I can never see it again. Why would anyone give the referees a standing ovation? So again, they were back, and that's what happened. So that was just a peek inside a dispute that was not players or owners. I thought it was interesting. It really had some issues that we don't see a lot, which are issues besides money and insurance, and again, more of a ego thing, because again, the NFL felt these referees were getting a little bit too thinking they were part of the game. So what a better way to put them in their place, so to speak, than to hire replacements, and they did. Think about that kind of aggression in negotiation where you actually hire replacements. And people, of course, watched. They were a curiosity. But as they keep saying, the abuse they got from players and coaches was really unfair. They didn't. They were just pawns, like I said. Okay, in our remaining minutes, what I think I'll do is, someone asked me this earlier, in all my years of negotiating, what were some of the most memorable contract negotiations I've ever had? And one actually happened when I was almost your age. I was an intern. I had started working for David Falk, one of the great basketball agents, and it was the early 90s, and we had a player, Duke University, who was one of the more accomplished, decorated college basketball players ever. His name was Danny Ferry. And Danny was someone I kind of hit it off with. He was a young guy. And he was drafted number 2 in the entire draft by the NBA draft by the LA Clippers, who were at that time, as everyone knows, a sad sack of a franchise. So when we're at the draft, I'll never forget this, Danny is up there, we're with him with his family, and then in the back of us, there's these two kind of little sort of squeaky Italian guys that kind of are following us around. So David, I'm the little, intern, kind of first year person there, and he says, go talk to those guys, see what they want. And they're like, can we talk to Danny Ferry? Can we talk to Danny Ferry? Please, please. And I said, well, he's about to be drafted in the NBA, like number 1 or 2 in the draft. What do you want? No, we want to talk to him about Italy. I'm like, he's not going to do that. What are you talking about? So I said to David, and David said, get rid of him, and I tried. Danny gets drafted, number 2. And, number 2 in the draft at that time is going to make about, $2 million a year. So that's one scene. About a week after the draft, we start getting these calls from a team called Il Messaggero in Rome. And they're saying, just can we please have a meeting? Can we please have a meeting? Just one meeting. So I am I say to David, they want a meeting. And we look it up, I do all the research, the highest contract in the history of European basketball, overseas basketball, anywhere in the world, was about $450,000 to $500,000 a year. About a quarter of what he would make in the NBA. So David's like, get rid of these guys. And I'm like, David, listen, I'm a new kid here. Can I take a meeting with them? And he's like, yeah, I guess. And I'm like leaving the office, skipping down the hall. I got a meeting. I'm a kid. I'm like, I got a meeting. So I call these guys. I said, I'll take a meeting. Me. And they're like, who are you? I'm like the intern, but I'm good. So we have a meeting. We have the day set up. I get up early. I wear my best suit. I'm all excited. It's my first meeting. And it turns out to be my most memorable negotiation of my life. I go in, and about the minute before it's supposed to start, David comes in and says, are you still doing this? I'm like, yes, please let me do it. He's like, well, get rid of them quick. I said, okay. So the receptionist says, Andrew, your guest is here. I said, great, I'll come get him. She goes, have you seen him? I said, no. She goes, okay, and she hangs up. And I'm like, that's a little weird. I come out, and I get this guy. You have to picture this. Enzo. Enzo works for Il Messaggero, the owner of the team who's in agribusiness. And Enzo is a lobbyist in Washington, D.C., where I was. Enzo knows nothing about basketball, doesn't know what a basketball is, doesn't know who Michael Jordan is, doesn't know what he's there to talk about Danny Ferry. Enzo is about this high and about this wide. He has these Coke bottle glasses, he has a white shirt, a black tie, black pants, big heavy shoes, and he is a mess. He's drinking like a Coke, or it's falling down his, he's a mess. But he is there. And I took a semester in Italy, so I'm starting some small talk. And it's, you know, about speaking Italian, whatever. I was a joke. And he looks at me, he goes, Andrew, he yells. So you gotta picture this. Enzo is sitting in front of me, and he's done with my small talk. And he comes up to me right here, puts his hand on my legs, and says, Andrew, how much will it take to sign Dan Ferry to Roma today? On my legs, squeezing. And David and I have talked about this, so I said, okay. David said, let's just get him out of the office. Let's tell him $3 million a year. 15 over 5, he can get out after any year. I said, Enzo, it's going to be 15 million over 5, 3 a year, he can get out after any year. And I'll never forget this as long as I live. He says, Andrew, what is your routing number? I said, what? What is your bank routing number? What do you mean? We will deposit 1.5 million today. 1.5 million when he arrives in Rome next week. I said, excuse me? Yes. Andrew, are we done? I'm like, no, we're not done. No, I have to go talk to David. Can you wait? Yes, Andrew, please be quick. So I run down the hall, he's on the phone. I said, you gotta understand, they're serious. He goes, they're not serious, they're serious. We're gonna have $3 million in the bank next week before he plays a game. In the bank. What? Yes. He says, go get other stuff. I said, okay. I'm gonna get other stuff. I'm excited. I walk back, Andrew, are we done? No. Enzo, Danny will need other things. What other things? Obviously, lodging. Yes, downtown villa in Rome with owner's son. Transportation. Brand new BMW. He needs family trips to come see him, girlfriend. Yes, how many? Three. Okay. Mommy, daddy, first class, girlfriend, coach. Okay. And then I realized, oh my God. Oh my God, I am 26 years old. I can ask for anything. I realized right then and there, oh my God, I can ask for anything, anything. And I'm racking my brain. He says, Andrew, are we done? I said, we're gonna need trips. Me and David, trips. How many?
Two.
Okay, David, first class, you coach. Anything else, Andrew? And then I realized, oh my God, this guy has come here and he has instructions to get Ferry signed today. Don't come back with a no. So I said, Enzo, you gotta wait, because he's like really rushing. I said, we gotta talk to this kid. And it was a perfect storm. We get Danny on the phone. His dad was a general manager in basketball, the Washington Bullets. And he realized what a disastrous franchise this Clippers team was. He didn't want to play there. And now he's got a real option. And we said to him, listen, there are two things going on here. Number one, this is real. We had now researched, there's a billionaire owner over there. But number two, your basketball is going to suffer. You know, it's not going to be Duke level basketball, certainly not NBA level. So you got to decide what to do. But this will be a record-breaking contract in the history of sports beyond the US. And he said, all right, let me talk. Me and my girlfriend are going to take a walk. I'm going to talk about this. He goes, I get it. It starts next week. You know, we got to make a decision. Because in European basketball starts way earlier than NBA. And he called back. He came back. He says, you know, I think we're going to do this. He says, here's what I want to know. They're allowed two Americans. He's like, who's the other American? I said, I don't know. I go back. I say, Enzo, who's the other American or foreign player? We are signing Pooh Richardson, UCLA. I go back. Danny says, I don't want to play with him. I said, why? He said, I don't like him. I said, okay. He says, you think you could change it out? I said, I think I can. I said, who do you want to play with? He said, oh, this guy, Brian Shaw. Can you get Brian Shaw? Like, I think I can. I said, Enzo, he don't want to play with Pooh Richardson. Why no Pooh? I don't know. He wants to play with this guy, Brian Shaw. Who's Brian Shaw? I said, he's a basketball player. Can we make that happen? He goes, that's the one thing he had to make a call about. So he made a call. I go back. He says, what does Brian Shaw want? I said, okay. We get Brian Shaw's agent on the phone. Brian Shaw's on the phone. Brian's like, can I get $1 million? I said, I think you can. So now David's in on this. David's like, you know, this is so extraordinary. You know, Brian's got to make like $1.5 million. And he's like, okay. They did it. They did it. And I went over there, and oh my God, it was exactly as they promised. It was this incredible villa in downtown Rome. They had every celebrity in Rome through there. They had day and night butlers and maids and chefs and the food. Oh my God. And they were living like kings at 22 years old. Now, the other part of it was the basketball part. Players were older, they didn't take it seriously. They practice at night. Players are smoking cigarettes on the bench. I mean, the basketball, Danny was a guy that, you know, took a lot of three-pointers. A lot of the Italian guys did that already. You know, he wasn't special. So the basketball didn't help. Meanwhile, postscript, David's able to get Danny's rights traded for a guy named Ron Harper to the Cavaliers while he's in Italy, signs while he's in Italy a 10-year, $45 million contract with the Cavaliers for Ferry when he comes back. So he played the 1 year. And of course, Danny went on to play a long time for the Cavs, then the Spurs, then general manager of the Spurs, then general manager of the Cavs, now with the Hawks. So it's quite a story. But I've never had a negotiation like that where you have all the leverage. All the leverage. I've never had that. Where you can ask for whatever you want. Even negotiating with someone like Brett Favre or Aaron Rodgers, they realized we had a salary cap, we had issues, we'd take care of other players. But in this case, it was pretty amazing. And I ran into Enzo where else at an Italian restaurant a few years later. And I worried, did I ask for too much? He says, you're a little, with the trips for you, it was a little much. I'm like, yeah, I know, I took the trips. And I did take the trips. But the reason I worried is because I learned through negotiating so much more that you don't want people coming off feeling they got taken. And I learned the hard way, because when I started, like at the Packers especially, I was out to prove like I could win these negotiations. I could get better deals for our team than other team people were getting. Other people like this guy coming in today. I thought that would really make me look good. And I realized that, and I would go to young players and I'd get these deals that were kind of tough for them later on in their careers. And it really came back to haunt me. Because we had young star players like question, why am I making only this much money? And why did Brandt take advantage of me? And I even did some contracts with players because I'm a former agent. I look at the players, look at me, they trust me. They say, I don't need an agent, I'll save the 3%. And I negotiate with them directly. And that was hard, because there it's raw. I appreciate the value of agents after those experiences, because agents are buffers. Negotiations are raw. You're telling someone their self-worth. You're telling someone what they're worth. And you're telling them they're not as good as the people they think they're as good as. So that was hard. I really lost some close relationships with players because I agreed to do that. It's not a good experience. So I had players later in my career come to me and say, I'll negotiate directly with you. And I said, don't. Don't do that. Hire an agent. I only deal with your agent. I'm not going to deal with you. They say, well, they don't want to pay the 3%. I'm like, well, figure out, pay less. So I always learned from negotiating. Enzo was my first experience where I always try to leave something on the table, because you're going to have the leverage and you're not going to have the leverage. And you deal with this in whatever business or law that you go into, you're going to deal with the same people. Bet your bottom dollar. You're going to deal with the same people over and over again. And you want people that want to deal with you. Like when I negotiated contracts, I dealt with hundreds of agents. When I pick up the file on a player and it said a certain name as their agent, I'd either go, all right, that's good, cool, I can deal with him. Or I'd look at a name and I go, I'd roll my eyes. It's going to be a tough battle. It's going to be not a tough battle. It's going to be annoying and not fun. You don't want to be one of those people. It has nothing to do with how good a negotiator you are. You want to be someone that people want to deal with. So what does that mean? Just not taking advantage of people. Treating people like you want to be treated. The last story is, there was an agent I dealt with a lot who passed away last year, named Eugene Parker. And he had Dion and Larry Fitzgerald. He's had some of the great players of the sport. Eugene Parker is someone I'll never forget, because what he did for me one year, we were negotiating our number one draft pick at the start of training camp. It was a big deal. It was our holdout. And it was very tense, because I'm negotiating this holdout and the whole Packer Nation is saying, when are you going to get this guy in camp? As that's happening, our player personnel director, who was in the next office, comes in one night and says, you need any help on this? I know you have a lot of stress. I said, no, I'm good. you can go. And he's like, all right, I'm going to go play golf for the last time because training camp was getting intense. He would never have time to play again. Anyway, about 6 hours later, we get a call that after golf, he went to have a beer and he came home and died of a heart attack. Now, I was very close with him, but so was Eugene. And I've got the whole world looking at me, when are you going to do this contract? When are you going to do this contract? And Eugene goes in front of the media and says something like, Andrew Brandt's like the best negotiator I've ever dealt with. This is going to happen on his time. He's grieving right now. I'll never forget that. That's how you want to treat people. Because I had other agents that were on my other picks were like, come on, let's get it done. I'm like, no, I can't do that right now. So when you make a little impression on someone like that, they'll never forget it. So take a personal interest. Negotiation, sports, it's about people. It's not about numbers. I'll leave you with that. Now, having said all that, you've been a great class. I really, first of all, let's give a hand to Sarah. She's been great. And the one thing I want to say is that I've dealt with a lot with you personally. You've come up and talked to me. I appreciate everything you've done for this class. I appreciate you listening to the structure, which is a little bit different than most classes. And understanding that I teach a little differently and flowing with it, not getting too stressed about what's on the exam and what's the structure and are we following this book or this case. But I've enjoyed teaching and I appreciate it very much. Thanks again. We don't have Howie Roseman, but we do have Jake Rosenberg. And don't be too disappointed. I make him feel bad. But Howie had to cancel last minute for a couple meetings, but we're lucky enough to have Jake. Jake Rosenberg, I'm gonna let him talk about himself, but a background in another world before getting into football and doing things in football similar to what you've heard about my background with the Packers and cap, contract negotiations, deal making, structuring everything to fit in this puzzle that we have in football of making 60 plus players fit in a nice box with the cap and contracts and dealing with all the agents, of course. Let's give a warm welcome to Jake Rosenberg. And I'll let Jake start by introducing himself, and if he would, Jake, welcome and go through your career arc to get where you come from and where you are today.
I'll be relatively brief, and then, Andrew wants to ask some questions, and if you guys have questions, we'll make this as conversational and relaxed as possible. I grew up in New Jersey. I went to Penn. Out of Penn, I was in management consulting for a couple of years, which brought me to Chicago on a long-term project. In Chicago, being around the trading floors and the exchanges, I kind of caught the trading bug. And for 13 years, I was a commodities trader. Part of the time on the floor at the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, and the rest of the time off the floor, I was a partner in an electronic trading firm where we primarily traded U.S. Treasuries. My trading career went from Chicago eventually to New York. Over the length of my career, I guess, I was, as time passed from college, I think my priorities changed and I became a little bit more honest with myself as far as career goals and kind of what drove me, and whereas maybe out of college I was a little bit more materially driven, and I realized pretty shortly thereafter that wasn't really going to sustain me. My true passion was always sports, definitely over the markets, and even when I was having the most success as a trader and in the financial industry, I still was far more inspired and passionate about the business of sports, all different aspects of sports than I was the markets. at various points either started sports-related businesses or talked to people within the industry trying to kind of figure out when or how I would be able to kind of cross over. And trading for me was more of a means to an end, and I knew it wasn't going to be like my life's work. Fortunate for me, as I was working in New York, living in North Jersey, through a relationship that I had at the Eagles with Howie. Howie had had a lot of people kind of in and out of the job that I have now, handling the financial side of the football team. Different background traditionally than mine. A lot of law students where that was more of a first job out of school. I came to it with a different breadth of experience, more, you know, a lot of practical real world experience, valuing commodities, valuing players, different, but a lot of the, a lot of overlapping skills, plus a big part of my job and maybe an underrated part, you know, I mean, there's certainly a quantitative aspect, but the way I've always looked at my job as, you know, Howie and I are really the sole contact the organization has with agents. So from a relationship management developing standpoint, all the time I had in trading, just being out in the world and different experiences I had, I thought made me kind of unique from other people that had been in that position to handle those relationships, take a lot of that off of Howie's plate. And so I took an internship, left the trading world, took an internship, which became a full-time position, and it's been 6 years that I've been at the Eagles. So my job, you know, the formal responsibilities, I run the football administration department, which, you know, in its strictest sense, everything that has to do with money and the players, so all our contracts, all our negotiation preparation, CBA compliance, our salary cap, you know, at the team level, and then kind of beyond that, you know, my office has been next to Howie's for the last 6 years, basically. So I have, you know, a seat at the table in all the major decisions. I'm sure, you know, most of you have a great enough awareness of the NFL and the way things are conducted. You know, there's no decision that's made from a roster standpoint that doesn't touch, you know, financial side of things, right? I mean, the NFL really has turned into, from a roster building perspective, an asset allocation game where, you know, it's money, it's draft picks, it's spots, you know, everything basically, it's a series of trade-offs. So you constantly, you know, there's no decision that's made in a vacuum. We can't have a roster full of, you know, 10 plus million dollar players. We can't have a roster of players that are all of comparable age or experience level, you know, so you're constantly making trade-offs, thinking this one player versus these two players, or those types of decisions. So we try to bring as much objectivity to every decision. You know, it's the financial side of it. It's, you know, how many picks, certain amount of money may be comparable to if you're talking about giving a signing bonus to a free agent. We just try to have, you know, all the information in as objective fashion as possible and make good decisions. So I help with all that stuff. And then, yeah, I mean, from a relationship standpoint, it's not, and in fact, most of the deals, and Andrew can attest to this, most of the deals don't necessarily go to the highest bidder and a player goes to a team because, you know, they're offering far more money. Most of the deals that get done over the course of the year, you know, maybe talking about street free agents, practice squad guys, futures that you sign, you know, right when the season ends that you're hoping will contribute for the next season. Most of those deals, money is not really a distinguishing factor. You know, you're talking about very, very small signing bonuses or no signing bonuses. And players are just choosing situations. Agents are hopefully guiding the player And a lot of those decisions that agents make and where to steer players are based on their relationship at the teams and where they're comfortable. You know, obviously from an agent standpoint, players are assets, commodities to them, right? They have invested in those players and they need to earn returns. So where an agent chooses to send his player, the good agents, you know, look at this like over an extended time frame, where are they going to see the greatest return on their player? And they hopefully are making decisions where they feel like that player has the best chance to develop, where the player has the best chance to perform and earn and pay the agent back. So, you know, that's it. I think people typically just think of players going where, you know, the show me the money thing, and that happens for a few days in free agency where not always, but players are making decisions largely based on the size of the deal, but then the rest of the year, it's a lot less of that, less than that, and it really is relationship oriented.
What's a typical day in the life? And obviously it changes from off season to season and maybe even in season, Monday, Tuesday versus the rest of the week.
Yeah. I mean, one of the great things about the NFL is each season definitely brings a different day, different set of tasks, you know, different kind of total what we're working on, you know, in its totality. In season, for me at least, or, you know, my side of things is not my busy season. You know, a good part of the regular season, I'm starting to look ahead to the off season. You know, we're always thinking about the longer term, the bigger picture. There hasn't been a day that goes by where each decision we make, we're not weighing next year and the year after with the short term. You know, in a salary cap environment, especially one where anything that we don't spend in this year, we can push forward. If we choose to spend money on an older player on a one-year deal for the now, you know, that's taking potentially money out of our pocket to sign a player in the off season who may be young and maybe a multi-year proposition. So, you know, we're always having that conversation. Different parts, I mean, now that we're getting, you know, the season clearly is crystallizing a little bit more, we have a greater sense of what we are as a team and what our ambitions are in 2017. So some of our decision-making processes are adjusting as well. You know, certainly in other more recent seasons, by this time in the year, we had kind of shifted the focus towards next year's roster and going forward. Now we're clearly trying to balance the now and recognizing the opportunity that's on the table, what's going on in the league and where we are, and making sure that, you know, that this window doesn't close on us without us doing everything we can, you know, to really try to win this thing and not suffer in the long term. And then, you know, as the season ends, we move really towards draft and free agency. My focus changes on those things. From a draft perspective, I get involved in the draft really after free agency has ceased and slowed down. Free agency has turned into a frenzy that dissipates very, very quickly. You know, the NFL free agency period has really, really shortened. Players aren't taking visits. Players aren't taking, you know, a week or two to make decisions. So for us, there's a legal tampering period leading into free agency where we're allowed to have negotiations with agents about free agents, and once that tampering period ends, we're off at 4 o'clock and we're able to sign. And you know, much like a game of musical chairs, I think there's a tremendous amount of pressure on agents and players to have their players placed at the end of that tampering period or within the first day of free agency, and that has resulted in just things moving very, very quickly. I mean, you really start to see expectations diminish really quickly after those first few days of free agency. And once that has happened, you know, you're really into value season. the length of deals is shortening at that point. You get players who didn't hit the market, didn't really capitalize like they were hoping, and their expectations at that point, you know, they're looking for the best opportunity on a short-term basis where they can get back to the market as soon as possible, and hopefully be in a more fortuitous situation. And once that happens, my focus changes to the draft, get involved in kind of helping organize our draft process, go through a lot of the scenario analysis where we're figuring out, you know, where we pick, other teams that pick in front of us, around us, you know, different needs, different trades that may arise, what we would do in certain situations, you know, getting involved in tiering the players and figuring out, well, you know, we may be indifferent between several players within a particular tier, in which case, you know, if X number of those players are still available, you know, we might be willing to trade back, things like that. And we go through all those exercises before the draft. So we feel like once the draft has started, you know, everything is really reflexive. We're not having a lot of, we're really not having discussions for the first time when we're on the clock or near the clock. You know, we always say, you know, clear heads and clear times. And so before the bullets start flying, you know, we really want to hash all that stuff out. And then once the draft is over, my job to get all the rookie deals done, all the rookies signed, which has become a much smoother process for the most part. There's minor skirmishes over minor issues just because you always have to fight over something, but it generally happens pretty quickly. The idea of players not being signed, really for the end of off-season program or even training camp, it's very seldomly happens at this point. And then training camp, you know, we've gotten into not really, no big money signings typically. You're just, you know, managing the roster, dealing with replacing injured players, looking at trades for where you're trying to trade out areas that you're deep for areas that you need some help. That's it. Just really always being prepared. You know, our philosophy with our good young players is always to try to keep them around. The NFL, I think more so than any of the other professional leagues, has a lot more risk when you're bringing in a player from the outside. From team to team, the schemes, coaches, just general culture is so different from one building to another and has a tremendous impact on the success of the players. So I think we always feel like when we're at a tremendous advantage when we know everything about a player that we have. And you'd almost prefer a player slightly less talented that you know everything about, rather than, you know, a player for another team where everything is going to be new and inevitably there's going to be, you know, warts that you didn't know, and it's really hard to know any of that stuff. You know, the LeBron Jameses of the world are not available in NFL free agency. So when you have good young players and you let them walk, you know, there really is not an easy way to replace them outside of the draft.
I'll open it up in a second, but I'd be remiss to not ask, you know, the social protest has been a big issue throughout the NFL season. Malcolm Jenkins, one of the leaders of all the players in that area. So on the surface, you guys have been pretty, I guess the word is lenient, liberal on the issue. You obviously have been in these meetings discussing league reaction versus team reaction, and what about comments from Jones and others about hurting the business overall, ratings down, etc. Mm-hmm. It's a lot to take in.
Yeah, so I mean, I guess I would probably stay away from the real big picture stuff outside of our team. Probably better off just staying away from. I can say that within our team, I think Malcolm Jenkins is the longest standing protester. He started doing it, I think, last year, within a game or two of when Kaepernick took a knee and he put his fist up during the national anthem. I would say for us, our owner is pretty liberal. And our owner has always talks about it being a family environment. So there have been a lot of conversations internally. I don't think at any point there was an effort to squash anything that he did. I think the effort has always been to understand. We've had players kind of off and on join with him. This season, we've had a consistent group of players who have, you know, Chris Long has been very vocal. I think Chris puts an arm around Malcolm when he puts his fist up. Ronnie McLeod, Torrey Smith. We have players who are very active in the community and have very strong opinions on issues, and they're backing them up. They're doing a lot of great work. They're spending time to understand the issues. We've had a lot of conversations in full team meetings with Coach Peterson, with our owner. Our owner had the commissioner in Philadelphia for a day where he took those players all over the city. They met with law enforcement. They met with with criminal activist groups. They met, just really trying to understand all sides of the issues and all understand each other's perspectives. And I think for us, the way our team is right now, I think there's an understanding. Others have chosen not to protest. It doesn't mean they feel any less strongly, but it hasn't really been a divisive issue for us. I really attribute that to communication and to, our owner's approach, where, he really tried to understand the issue. As far as broader league implications, I think, clearly there are some, but that's a little beyond probably my sphere at this moment.
Last thing I'll ask is, obviously, it's been a blessed season so far. And you talked about it in terms of the way you're making moves, reflective of that. I know you're going to answer it this way. You got to keep your head down, not get excited about where you are. Long way to go, and that's what Doug and Howie tell me all the time. But you know that you're having the success. You just talked about how the moves you're making are reflective of that. Is it hard to sort of keep that euphoria away from doing your job towards the bigger prize?
It is hard. It's a good problem to have. Yeah. It's better than the other problem I have where I'm trying to keep my despair for my kids and trying to not let them walk around all mopey and angry. This particular case, I think trying to balance being excited about where we are and what's in front of us and the opportunity we have with sticking with the process and kind of what's gotten us to this point. I think really, that falls to Coach Peterson for the coach, for the players as far as keeping them focused. I also have this conversation with myself on a regular basis, I feel like when you work in the league, the way injuries come about on just such a regular basis. I mean, you're constantly dealing with getting punched in the face, hey, we won, but we lost our best player. Hey, and so you're trying, it's a business, but at the end of the day, it's sports and it's your passion and just the competition, drives you to such an extent. I am trying to enjoy the success, make a conscious effort to enjoy it and not just be typically miserable, like we all try to be during the season. It's nice to see, and the city is just so on board, and you can't help but feel all the excitement. And I guess I just, we've exceeded expectations to this point, but I really think that the cornerstones of our plan, like this is kind of what the plan was, maybe. The timeline has been accentuated. I feel like some of the things that have happened around the league have been to our benefit. So no one is, hoisting 8-1 banners, but I think that we are also trying to, you're used to learning lessons from failure, so we're also trying to embrace some success to this point, and that's where I stand. I'm really in for my family. You know, I am trying to get them to enjoy it, and kind of this is why sometimes I'm not around that much, and this is what we're trying to do, and this is where, you know, the fun lies. And so,
questions. Identify yourself and your. Go ahead.
Sorry, I'm Jack Mazzullo. I was kind of wondering, because it seems like you come out of like everybody's dream job, and you went from something that you did for a while and realized maybe you don't like as much as you thought you did. Is there anything you don't like about your job? Like, don't work as anything? You're like, you know what? I wish I was doing something else that just kills me, or is it just.
Yeah, I mean, there's, you know, there are. It's not like sunshine and rainbows, you know, every day. I think there's definite trade-offs. You know, it's personal choices as far as what's important. I know for me, if I didn't love sports and if game days weren't so important to me and I didn't really relish the competitive side of it, the team building side of it, I think that you could see it getting a little like repetitive for certain people as far as the cyclical nature, the constant, you know, one step forward, two steps back, you know, the injuries. It's like, I'm thinking like if you're a developer and you build houses or buildings, you know, once you start a building, you have plans and the building is gonna look a certain way when you're done. Like for us, I feel like we have plans. They start in January or February for the following team. For the final season, you know, we start to execute the plan. We may get to May or June and feel like, wow, you know, we've got a great plan. And then by, it could be, in 2013, we lost Jeremy Macklin in the second practice of training camp, not even a, you know, padded practice. You know, he wasn't even touched, and he tore his ACL and was out for the season. So it's like, you know, you're trying to build that house or that building, and then you come back the next day and the building is like, you know, knocked to the ground. Like that element of it, you know, it's not a science, it's an art. Like, that's frustrating, you know. And then for us, you know, we talk about like a training camp from a team building or roster building perspective. It's like we're ceremonially handing over the keys to the coaching staff. We don't really have control over how the players are used, or how the game plans are designed or executed. So in a vacuum, we bring in player A, you know, in March in free agency, and we pay X for him. And the coaches are like, oh yeah, he's going to do this, and he's gonna play, you know, 60% of our snaps. And then you get to September and player is like not on the field, and the way the game plan looks is totally different than, you know, what you were described in March. Who's on the hook for that? Well, it's us, because we brought in a player who doesn't look like he fits. We wasted money, he's not playing. So I think that there's elements of the job that are, you know, you're constantly like hammering, and you just don't have a lot of control over things. I also, the reality of working in sports is that there's so many people who want to work in sports. You know, it's a supply and demand, so the supply is so great that there's not really a necessity to pay people tremendous amounts of money to do it. So I think if you're smart and capable, and you have a choice between going into, you know, capital markets or going into professional sports, you may wind up, you know, at the far end, you know, in a tail and make a lot of money or comparable money. But when you, you know, over a 25-year career in professional sports versus a 25-year career in capital markets, I think you would bet on the capital markets far out earning, you know, a career in sports. So, you know, that's a trade-off, because you're not working any less, you're not putting any less of yourself into it, but you need to extract the value from your profession in some of those other intangible things. I mean, I feel like, you know, part of my paycheck are game days, are experiences I get to have with my family, or my kids being around the team, you know, having players over for dinner, my kids having relationships, you know, knowing the players at that level. Like, that's meaningful to me. And I feel like, to me, because of the way I value all these things, like that offsets not earning, not having certain material things that I probably would have if I, you know, worked in a different line of work. I would say that it's great. I love it, my passion and everything, but I don't think that there's any jobs where you're going to not have certain travails, and you know, it's not that.
Jason
2-0. I'm just curious, the last couple of years after the draft, going after undrafted rookies, you guys have been pretty aggressive, a lot of guaranteed money, and a lot of times it works like the moment this year. I was just wondering kind of what's the strategy on that and why you guys outpaced the league.
Yep.
And then my second question would be, when you're building a roster, do you set aside like a certain amount, like a range for this position and then this position, or is it more fluid depending on who's available and what you have?
Yep.
And how do you structure it that way?
Those are good questions. On the first question, we have been extremely aggressive in undrafted free agency, and we have far outpaced the league in guaranteed money paid to undrafted. So just like the 1 minute explanation, you know, there's a draft, 7 rounds, everyone has picks, make them, and then once the draft ends, any of the 1,000 odd players who think they're going to be drafted that haven't been drafted, the 700 plus that haven't been drafted, once the last pick is made, it's basically a free-for-all where teams start calling agents trying to sign players. The only restriction we have is on the total signing bonus that we can give to those players. So anyone who meets that criteria as far as an undrafted free agent, draft eligible and not selected, this year was, I think, $92,000, like, total salary amongst however many you need. And everyone is operating on that same constraint. What we're not constrained on are these guarantees, where we're basically writing into their contract that we're willing to guarantee them a certain amount of their salary. So in the NFL, just going back one more step, unless it's explicitly guaranteed, the salary is not guaranteed. Unless the team has negotiated where all or part of a salary is guaranteed, we can cut a player at any time and not pay them beyond that point. So it's very unique to the NFL versus the other professional leagues. And over the course of a season, you know, as we cut players, their paychecks end. So in undrafted free agency, you know, one of the little advantages, I guess, that we've found, we offer these guarantees to players to help recruit, because we may offer $5,000 signing bonus or $10,000 signing bonus, which any other team might, and then we add these guarantees. And we feel like if we select we go after the right players, every guarantee has an offset. So every guarantee, basically, they only get paid their guarantee if they don't earn that money anywhere in the NFL this season, for that particular season. So we're not betting necessarily that they'll be on our team. We're betting that at some point they may be on someone else's roster or practice squad. So typically 85% of the dollars that we guarantee are offset. So we're only paying 15 cents on a dollar. So a player may look at it like, oh, I have a $20,000 guarantee. And we may look at it like, well, on average, we just gave him $3,000 because we only gave him 15%, you know, in cash. If that helps us get better players, then, you know, that's an advantage we have. So we've been extremely aggressive with those guarantees. And in years where we haven't had a lot of picks, you know, last year we went crazy. I mean, last year we didn't have a second round pick, and we went into it and said, you know, so 2015, our head coach took over personnel responsibilities. So Howie and I were, our role was reduced a little bit and changed. So we were off, like, on the other, literally our offices moved to the other side of the building. And so we had a lot of time to have conversations about all kinds of different things. We went all over the country, met smart people within sports, outside the sports. And when we came back in 2016, we didn't have all our draft picks. The roster definitely needed a younger infusion of talent. So one of the ways that we felt like we would be able to buy, I guess, you know, more picks was that strategy. And it's been good, I think, in hindsight. It's surprising that more teams don't do that.
Yeah.
And then overall, from just a roster composition and whether we budget certain money per position, I would say that you can't really do that. You know, you're dealt the hand. You just kind of have to play the cards that you're dealt. You know, you may sit there in a vacuum and say, if I was starting a team tomorrow, my highest paid players would be my quarterback. I'd have a quarterback, a corner, a pass rusher, you know, and a left tackle. And those would be the guys I'd pay the most. Well, if your best player is a defensive tackle, which, you know, our best defensive player is, you can't really swap him out for a corner, or, you know, you need to sort of build around that guy because you're not going to get a lockdown corner in free agency. You know, you're going to get the corners that will be in free agency. Some other team has decided that they have some kind of fatal flaw or wart that, you know, they don't want to deal with, or they're not worth the money that they're asking for. So, I mean, we look at allocation by position, but you can't really look at the positional allocation just on dollars. You know, the way that the rookie salary cap, or, you know, the draft pool goes, those guys, if you strictly look across our team, you'll say that we, at the moment, our backup quarterback plus our starting quarterback, you know, would say that we're not investing heavily at quarterback, right? Because their starting quarterbacks in the league are making $25 million. But I don't think that anyone would say that we haven't invested heavily in quarterback based on the, you know, draft pick allocation to Carson. So I think you need to, in order to really do that analysis, you kind of need to look at really all the assets. This kind of circles back to what we started. You know, assets may be money, but it also may be picks and opportunity, and you kind of need to take that whole thing, you know, into account.
You guys moved heaven and earth to draft Carson, and he's been a revelation, obviously. Yep. But how do you know that?
So exciting.
You didn't have that much. You didn't have that much time with him to really know that he'd be this.
Well.
This miracle.
I guess a miracle. Yeah, I mean, I do feel like it's a miracle. No, I think that you don't. So again, this is just like any decision you make in life. You know, there's very few decisions you're going to make where you're going to have 100% certainty. So what you're trying to do through the process is, you know, I go back to gambling analogies like all the time, right? So if you play blackjack, you're never going to make it, you know, a perfect proposition, but the closer you play, you're just trying to really maximize your odds. In the pre-draft process and as it related to the decision on quarterbacks, I really feel like we exhausted every resource to try to distinguish and vet the options that we had. Whether Carson is better at this point versus where we may have thought or not, I don't know that that's that significant. I think what we did, though, was we were making a very significant decision. We looked at it from every possible side and said, you know, versus other players in this position, you know, better, same, worse, and kind of went through all kinds of different analysis. And we did spend a lot of time with him, as much time as we possibly could, I would say. Whether it was a private visit to North Dakota where he threw, went out to dinner, got on the whiteboard with the coaches, interviewed the combine, a 30 visit where he came to the facility and spent a day with us again with the coaches, met with several different psychological tests, evaluations. I mean, really, there's just so many different ways to try to get to know a player, and there's always going to be variables that you don't have control over, but it's, you know, are you 50% confident this is the right guy? Are you 55, 60, you know? And for us, we're not going to bat 1,000. We're trying to have a really good process where this is, you know, sometimes I, like, as I'm speaking, this is exactly the way I was approached trading too. Like, you're trying to have a good process where most of your decisions will work out, not all of them. And if you keep repeating that process and making good decisions over time, you know, your good decisions will outweigh your bad and you'll have good results. I think you can't live with making bad decisions that were the result of a bad process, but as long as you're comfortable with what the process is leading into the decisions, the outcome really is out of your hands. And I think when we picked Carson, everything we could have done, we had, and everything we had done told us that this guy had a tremendous chance to be, you know, a transcendent player for us. And, you know, make no mistake about it, I've sat there and watched the Packers or watched the Saints or the Patriots, and you just sit there and you're like, wow, life must be so easy if you've got one of those guys.
Yeah, it was nice.
I mean, you just like start, you know, basically you sit there every year and you're like, all right, we've got 8 wins already. You know, because those guys, you know, they are just a huge eraser. I mean, they literally can take a whole bunch of bad things and turn it into a good thing, and they can take a whole bunch of, you know, just okay middling players, and, you know, it's incredible. And
but what you did is you maneuvered, you made a decision that you can't get one of those guys unless you're at the top.
Yeah.
And you maneuvered. I mean, we were in Green Bay and the guy fell in our lap,
right,
which is right, still unbelievable.
Rare, yeah.
But you obviously made that decision, and then you had to get there, which was hard.
Yeah, I think, I give Howie a ton of credit because, you know, having a several year period of where it was tumultuous and a lot of time to reflect and think about, you know, like, basically we're not going to go out like that. Like, we're not going to just sit here and just, you know, be like in the gray area. You know, we're going to swing for the fences. We're going to try to win a championship. And if we don't take a chance or take that shot, you know, you're going to regret it forever. You have to understand, in the NFL, it's not like it's a secret. Like, you know, we talked about undrafted free agency and these guarantees. Like, you may feel you have an advantage because other teams haven't figured that out. There's nobody at any team that doesn't realize that, you know, you need a great quarterback to win and win consistently. So for us, the opportunity was not just, hey, there's a quarterback we feel great about. It's also, we've got a chance to get there, and also the teams that have a chance to take this quarterback seem to not feel similarly, and, you know, that's just a very unique situation. And just looking ahead to, you know, this generation of great quarterbacks we have are getting older. You know, those teams have been perpetually the good teams, and they're starting to, I mean, the Giants, you know, clearly are starting that process where they're starting to think about life after Eli. So it wasn't going to get any easier to get to the top of the draft and be in a position to take one of those players. So the opportunity to get there, having a player there, and having those teams that were at the top of the draft say that they don't need or don't want, you know, that all lined up in a very lucky way for us. And I don't know. Hopefully, you know, the end of the story hasn't been written, but I feel like that's a very lucky situation.
Yeah. And the Bridgewater injury.
The Bridgewater injury was a lucky situation.
Yeah.
I mean, how Carson, you know, how the last 2 years would have changed if, you know, Sam was still there. You know, we just don't know. But, yeah, that clearly worked to our advantage.
Questions? I mean, the question I'm sure a lot of them are thinking is, how do they get, not necessarily to the jobs that you or I had, but what advice to young people getting into sports at all levels?
I mean, I would say a week does not go by where I don't have at least one kind of introductory conversation with someone who's, you know, sent an email or a resume or something, asking the very simple question, like, how do I get a job in sports? And I think from my perspective, the guys and gals that we look to hire are people who have, you know, at this point, you know, the easiest thing is to send it, you know, is to send an email. I'll give anyone here my email address. It's really easy to sit there and say, hey, I love sports. You know, I want to do this really badly. And, you know, I'll work all day and night and you don't have to pay. Like, get lots of emails like that. And people are super qualified. The part that I think takes that to the next level and distinguishes those that we wind up hiring are the people who have said, hey, I want to do that. And I've studied the CBA on my own. I've studied contracts on my own. I've built this database on my own, you know, or unsolicited will send me, say, hey, you know, it looks like you guys may need whatever next year in free agency. You know, this is what the free agency market will look like, and this is where I think these guys are going to get paid. And or it may be, hey, for you guys, you know, Tim Jernigan is going to be a free agent next year. This is what the kind of deal that I think, you know, he'll look for. This is, you know, like those kind of, I mean, I think that there's so much good information available that there really is hardly any excuse for, you know, coming to us and not having kind of devoured that all and have something to offer in conversation number one. Like, I will put, you know, very in a friendly way, but, you know, I put someone on the spot and say, okay, so what have you done? You know, I don't expect people to have experience working in a team because it's, you know, I mean, you just need a good break. You need a relationship or whatever to get in. And I'm not expecting that, but it's okay. You know, what are you doing on your own to kind of distinguish yourself and go beyond the email or the letter? So, I mean, that's the biggest thing for us, I think, is it's a small, like, especially on the football ops side, it's a very small headcount. There's just not a lot of people. We spend an inordinate amount of time together, you know, and it's a crazy thing. When we travel together, you know, we'll fly to Dallas on Saturday. We have a night game Sunday night, so we'll spend a good part of the day Saturday, all day Sunday. Then we sit and watch the game together, either in press box or suite, which is, like, you know, so super stressful, anxiety-ridden time. You want to work with similarly minded, passionate people who are all in as well. You know, I'm leaving my family for 2 days. My kids have activities I'm missing. There's just not a place for someone in the business who's kind of half it. You know, saying, yeah, I'm here, but I wish I was home. I wish I was, you know, like, we're all committed to one thing. And so I think that's important to convey. Like, when I ask that question, like, where else are you interested in working? And it's, well, I may go into real estate, I may go into markets, I may go into sports. And it's kind of, I mean, it's, I understand you have to have fallback options and you have to have other things, but it's, you know, in this career in particular, I really think that the passion, and you kind of need to be all in.
And I'll add, you know, not only show your special skill, but when you say I love sports, that doesn't do much for people. But what they do like is, I want to be X, Y, Z, and here's what I've done towards that already. You know, I want to bring an analytical approach to salary cap management. I want to do this, and here's what I've done towards that regard already. And right away, you've sort of separated yourself from the hundreds to just say, I love sports, I want to be in operations, I want to be in PR. And then, even if you send something and it's not in the area, you can forward it on to the right person, and that gives it another stamp of approval.
Yeah, I that's an excellent point. And I do tell people, you know, this isn't like the baseball draft where we're taking a 16-year-old and we're just saying best player available and we're going to, like, mold him into a player when he's 23. Like, you know, if I get a resume and someone's like, I don't know what I want to do, maybe personnel, maybe salary cap, it's not that I'm the busiest person in the world, but it's hard for me, without knowing a person and knowing their skills, to say, oh, I could turn this into this person into a great salary cap person, or I could, like, you got to bring kind of the, you got to present the picture. And I think that that is important. It's not just enough to say, I want to work for a football team. Okay, well, what do you want to do, and how are you going to do it, and how are you going to distinguish yourself? I mean, the calls were, well, I want to either be in scouting or I want to do salary cap. Well, those are totally different worlds and totally different paths, and, you know, it's hard to, for me to say you're better at one than the other, you know, that's really on you.
Yeah, and then when you, if you're lucky enough to get in at any area, then be open to the unknown, as I call it. Be open. You hear somebody down the hall has got something, yep, I'll do it. You know, because then you make yourself really invaluable. Final questions? Okay, I will stick around if anyone has any questions about end of semester stuff. I will volunteer Jake to stick around a little bit, and let's give him a warm appreciation for that.